Board of Finance meeting. It's slightly full agenda, so let's get going. We will start with public comments, and first I have Scott Van Pelt. I'm not gonna post it up here, Scott, but I'll do my thing.
All right. Hi there, Scott Van Salkma. I live in the district. The curriculum and finance meetings, to my knowledge, did not have regular meeting minutes posted on the board book website until September 2021. Why not? You're also missing the following committee meeting minutes after that started for these board finance committees, specifically September 14th, 2021, April 12th, 2022, and November 14th, 2023. Looking into the agendas of some of those older committee meetings, some have links to minutes, and what is there is pitiful, and they tell nothing. Thankfully, the committee meeting packets and minutes are getting more informative, but they should still be better, in my opinion, especially since these meetings are sparsely attended by parents, taxpayers, and stakeholders. This would have been really helpful for you regarding the cell phone tower, to at least so that people could see what was talked about. Parents would have learned more about it before it got to the last minute, almost signing the lease. Having the meeting on video, we could have also gone back and watched the discussion or learned of the discussion instead of the very small blurbs in the minutes. These are very important decisions that you are talking about with the literal health and safety of our kids. Something to add more information about, just as a for instance, is this new classroom furniture that you guys are going to be buying for $232,000. You know, what it looks like, what the bids are, anything along those lines would be great. I'm sure that you'll show these things in a presentation today like I've seen in the past, but why not put it in the packet? Also, the $46,000 that's being used for AV equipment in the new administration building, will that be able to record videos of the meetings as well? And if not, why was that not put into the build? I mean, since you guys are still authorizing the spending of money for that new building, how about adding video systems in there, at least in the boardroom meetings, so that you guys could record those? You know, that's really obviously easy to install in construction. I mean, why are these meetings not recorded, and why do I have to do it? During the January 20th, 2020 special Board of Education meetings, there was discussion about committee member assignments. And then there was a large gap on the board book website where there was no finance or curriculum meetings from May 26th and May 28th, 2020 were the last committee meetings until September 14th and 15th, 2021. There's nothing posted regarding finance and curriculum meetings. I mean, did those meetings not even happen? I mean, there's no agendas, no minutes, no nothing. Now, I understand that was during COVID, but you guys did still post regular BOE meetings that were virtual. So I will give Dr. Schubel some slack on a lot of this since this was in place before she got here. But since you guys are supposed to hold the superintendent accountable, according to the website, what the BOE does, you guys aren't in the day-to-day minutia, but please either have her, you know, basically get her house in order and, you know, make the administration do what they're supposed to do. I mean, again, these are government institute. This is a government institution, and it should be open and public for government. So thank you. And again, I'm not expecting Dr. Schubel or Christine or Julie to post all these things, but there's a lot of people that work in this building. Thank you.
Regarding the cell tower, Robert commends Julie Davis for asking the board to postpone the vote for the tower at the last board meeting. Based on some comments made by board members during the finance meeting and the curriculum meeting, if the cell tower was voted on at Monday's school board meeting, it probably would have passed. Julie did the smart thing. The panel at the Eastern High School cell tower meeting was ill-prepared, though, by not having a Verizon tech to answer questions regarding the community's biggest concern, radio waves and the effects on teachers and students that will be near the tower 5 days a week. Also, what will happen if the other two major carriers want to add their panel antennas that emit between 700 megahertz, 700 million, that's 700 million hertz, to 5 gigahertz, 5 billion hertz, and how those waves will affect people that are near the tower for extended periods of time. The board was saved embarrassment if the tower was voted on and passed from having lawsuits and protests and being put in a very bad position. What would have made it worse This is poorly thought out ongoing policy of having all public comments at the end of the board meeting. There were people that wanted to speak about their concerns about the tower, but due to how the board handling public comments at the end of the meeting, the vote would have been taken first. It would be too late for people to be able to ask the board to vote no on signing the contract to install the tower. Once again, Robert asked the board to reconsider having public comments at the end of the board meetings. The cell tower issue is a perfect example as to why comments should be at the beginning of the board meeting. If the board is determined not to change the current policy, I suggest having two public, that's Robert, well, and me too, have two public comments, one at the beginning to only discuss items on the agenda, and then one at the end for non-agenda topics the public wishes to address. Many school boards and townships do their meetings in this format. Robert and I hope that you will do the right thing regarding the public comments. Thank you for listening. And I do attend the Cascade Township meetings, and that is the way that they handle it. They do have public comments in the beginning for items on the agenda to address any concerns and information that may impact what's being voted on. And then they do have public comments again at the end for whatever other concerns there are. So it's a good format, and it does provide the public an avenue if they have something that's of concern that you, then you can address as you're doing the vote. Thank you. Under discussion items, I leave monthly financial statements because we normally do that. As you know, the timing for this meeting, we moved it up a little bit in consideration of our midwinter break that we'll need. So the timing does not work well for monthly financial statements. January ended last week, Wednesday. So we do not have those to present today. We're still kind of closing out January. So at our March meeting, we'll be presenting both January and February too. But I wanted to leave that on there and folks understand. Bond construction update. Avisa and Pine Ridge continue to progress as scheduled. We have been having a little bit of fun at Avisa because that building wasn't constructed as a public school building, so it had some different rules and certain instructions. So as we are moving through the phases, we're finding lots of fun things in there, and it's, you know.
Not the first time.
Not the first time, right?
Yep, that's living when we took the building over. It was gone.
Yeah, so we're discovering the same way. So it's nice because we're able to fix some of the things that maybe aren't in the best condition. On top of there, is there really any foundation underneath that? So those types of things we're running into. So we continue to progress through that, but know that that may lead as we go through it, there may be an instance at the end when we might be coming back to you for an increase because we're kind of going through our contingency, which is what it's for. Admin Transition Center is also moving along. We are expecting to be able to move in from the Administrative Services side in April. And then we're working through what that Transition Center will move will look like. Obviously, those students will finish off the school year in their building. But we're having conversations with both Sarah and Jan about having some of those students. They are interested in having some of the students help pack up some of the things. Like, you think of the life skills room and what it's like, right, pack up some of the kitchen, silverware, plates, or whatever it is, right, and then bring it over and then unpack it and help
So we're working through that piece with them, so we're pretty excited. At Central Middle School, we are definitely wrapping up that. We talked just a second ago about 887. We ran into some of those strange issues at Central Middle School early on in the project, and I think we talked about it probably here. And one of the early on things we found was some very rusted arch of water pipe was not in good condition. So as we've gone through the phases and continued to monitor that, as we wrap that up, we might be bringing a recommended increase. There's a couple of scope projects that we would like to include in that that work in the original. And one of these we have a couple ideas. As we finish the building, there's a section where we think there's some doors that need to be replaced, but we've used the contingency for things along the way. The big one, that chilled pipe was around $250,000 for those fixes, so that was a lot. So I just wanted to put it on your radar that probably as we're working through some pricing for the things like the doorway, there's a tile that we weren't going to replace, but we think we might ask to replace it. So we're getting pricing and seeing what that looks like, and we might bring that back to you for the March meeting, and we'll give a rather robust description of that at that meeting if we can bring it to you. And then two last things related to out of the new bond. We're continuing our design work for both Eastern High and Northern High as a couple of the athletic projects. Those schools had identified those projects which they would like to have the first priority. Over Eastern, that was the ball fields, the softball and the baseball fields. And then for us, included in that is trying to create a secondary drive, access drive, and on that campus. So that design work is continuing along with Northern High's selection. Theirs was now it's over a turf field, so if they go over Central High, they have that second turf field. That was their first choice. So we're working through those designs with that group.
Was the stadium at Northern brought up anywhere?
It's a part of the project. It is, yes. It was a part of the scope. It is not their first. They wanted to really get that so a turf field and kind of help out with competitions that we have. Soccer and lacrosse in the spring is really busy.
Yeah.
So.
And is the plan for that, like bringing the softball field area or that?
No, actually, it is actually we're going to put it in the sea bowl. So if you think of there's that lower bowl right now that we use for some practices. I think there's like a skin baseball infield between the middle school and the high school.
Uh-huh.
Is that lower area? That is where that will be located.
That's okay.
Yeah. And then the last one for bond construction is the aquatic center. So we sent out invitations for a focus group that will meet just a couple of times, and that is comprised of staff and community members and students. So that invitation has gone out, and we also sent out an invitation for design. So that's a little bit scaled back though. There's some parent reps on that and some staff as well. They may include students just because of the frequency of when we're going to be meeting. We think their voices will be heard with the focus group as well as a survey. So our goal is to get that survey out this week. It's ready. We just need to push it out. And so we're going to push it out through our students. We're going to do that and their parents through the final forms that they use right now for even registering to participate in place. So it's a good avenue to send it out. And then we're pushing out the community side through our community enrichment that uses that along with, this is probably the resources. We're going to look to try to get a couple of Chromebooks or something on site and have that availability, maybe some paper copies or something, so folks who are coming on site and using the Aquatic Center. So trying to get a variety of stakeholder feedback on what they would like to see in the new Aquatic Center.
So it could be an obvious answer, but differentiate between focus group and design group with different goals?
Try to get some more people. The focus group wanted to be able to hear from students more than just the survey is a big one. And they'll only meet a couple times. And we'll have somebody come in and we'll jump off and fit. The design group is the group then that will take information from the survey, take information from focus group, and then we'll meet on some sort of cadence, whether it's every other week or, that's typically the beginning, you're doing it more frequently. meeting every other week. And then as you progress through, there's a more of a gap. The design group will also be the folks who will, when we go do some site visits, because we know in this particular case we want to go with them. So, examples, right?
Right.
We don't know what we don't know.
That's great.
So that's the reason for the two groups.
Good.
Start the day with the survey, do a focus group, and then do that design group.
Good.
In our plan, partway through it somewhere, not sure where, is then bring that focus group back in. Say, okay, here's what we've been working through. You know, what's your gut reaction? What is your
perfect
concept?
Great.
Right, that is our construction update. So that takes us to our action items. We have our minutes from our meeting. And then our next action item is for classroom furniture. So we, in this request, we are finishing the classrooms at Central Middle School. So this one's solely focused on Central Middle School. So we have the last few classrooms at that school to do. We have done the other rooms a couple different times throughout the phases, as well as those couple group spaces. If you remember the design, when you walk into the entryway, and it's now going to not be that up and over and then go back, right? It'll all be one big thing. We've got a collaboratory space and a big presentation space. So this is filling those two spaces with furniture, like I said, along with the last two classrooms. So we use the same process that we did for the classrooms, that we did for the rest of the building, and that teachers had three options in which to choose a classroom setting. There was a variety of seating. It was a two-person table to serve as a desk, with maybe some individual desks in there, and just some variations of that, along some storage and a teacher's desk. So they had those same options to choose from. They had flexibility on their teacher desk, so that the three options, they had to get A, B, or C related to the student desk option. They couldn't mix it preset. What they had flexibility on was they had a couple different choices for their teacher stations, and then they had some different choices related to storage and shelves and that type of thing. So that's where they had that flexibility. From what they selected, and then from what the building selected from those larger group spaces, we're recommending to purchase that furniture from Custer, Duell, Great Lakes Furniture Supply, Interface Interiors, for an amount not to exceed $232,321. All of those companies have the furniture is off purchasing cooperatives, so that cooperative is done by bidding on behalf of the district, and those purchasing cooperatives are E&I, KPN, and Ambium. We do have, for next month, we will have more furniture, just kind of an FYI. We have some schools. We are trying to maybe get that going a little bit sooner, because we know there's going to be a time frame before we can circle the hall about updating our environments, as well as the 5-6 building as well. So we will have that one for you next month. Questions on the furniture? All right, administration, building, the AV equipment. So this is specifically for the two large multi-purpose rooms. So if you think of the Fine Arts Center, right now there's the big multi-purpose rooms that can either be one large or two smaller ones. We built the same thing in the new administration building as well, and it's on the second floor. So Susan and her team have been working on what does that look like from a technology perspective, and when we hold meetings there, whether it's a Board of Education meeting or it's a professional learning with our teachers, what are our needs, and they're kind of diverse when it comes to that. So this recommendation is to purchase a variety of equipment from Digital Age Technologies using REMC contract pricing. So again, REMC is still limited for us. We just secured a quote from DAT, as we call them. So the amount is not to exceed $46,800. And that includes microphones for meeting tables. So think about your Board of Education meetings, the microphones there. It can be used for if you're having something that prefers panel discussion or a variety of uses. It's also to purchase the projectors and large format displays. In integrated control system, and Susan will have to explain that one a little bit for us, and an audio amplification speaker, so when somebody is a presenter, they have a means to project their voice without having to yell, so that everybody can hear. Do you want to maybe talk through the integration piece for us?
Integrated controls would be where, because the space can be either one large space or two independent spaces, we have a control system on the wall where you're presenting in the whole room, the audio would go in both spaces, the screens would display the same thing or different things. So the buttons on the wall that basically connect all of those systems, and the audio, and I would display, and you can have the room, kind of connects all of the systems.
Little tangent, we have lots of spaces in the district that operate that way. Is that a retrofittable concept, or do we, you know, teachers that team teach and you try to separate them, you can't because it's something on a long term to do list? Or
we've done a lot of homegrown things to try to make those spaces work.
Okay.
And this is an option that really integrates better. So when you come in the room, it's going to take you 10, 15 minutes to set up the space the way you want it. It'll be ready for you. Just choose the options you need for that space.
Right.
And so timeline-wise, we wait. Is this how we would typically do this with a build like this, or we design, we wait and get that space in, and then we add this piece in? Like, why wasn't this piece known, like, when we designed the building? This is the system we're going to put in there. This is the requirements we want. And part of that original dollar amount.
Right. The design would include things like, where are we putting the electrical, the outlets? Where are we putting the cabling in behind? Anything that's behind the finishes, behind the walls? So all of that part was part of the construction, and then the point, which was decided a long time ago, and then we go up a bid for the actual things that will attach to those.
Right. Oh, okay, okay. So
we had to wait on purpose, right?
Yeah,
it was planned, but you may.
Yeah.
Like any.
So the stuff behind the walls and things obviously was built into the design. This is just the physical stuff
that
we're looking up to it.
Yeah.
Okay,
yeah,
that makes sense. Okay. That's what my question was.
Yeah.
Wouldn't we consider all this before we put everything in place? I mean, obviously the ceiling's still not in or whatever. But okay, yeah, that makes sense. Two spaces.
We think about it in general terms of that, right? Where will we need the cabling? Where will we need the power? We hold off on the equipment on both sides of the end. The changes,
right?
And so we want to make sure that we don't buy something and then have a little bit of remorse for you and whatever you can put it up.
Yeah. Excellent. Okay.
The next action item is an interesting one. So we are requesting to purchase 15 Chromebook carts. If you think about those Chromebook carts, they store, charge a Chromebook or any type of a service up to a certain size of device can fit in there. Actually, it doesn't have to be a Chromebook. And so we're recommending purchasing 15 of those that will house up to 36 devices. The per unit cost is a little over $2,000. So the grand total is $30,865. And the reason is the PSAT and SAT that occur in April are now computer-based. So we've been working with our assistant principals at our buildings who are the ones who kind of oversee that testing. And some of the things we've been working on is even tables. Chris has been helping them order the right number of tables and chairs for the students to be testing. But obviously we have a need for technology that's all going to be online. So we are in a good place related to actual devices themselves. What we would like to do is be able to purchase the carts to house those devices so that we can move them from site to site. Schools don't test on the same day, which is nice, because then we don't have to have extra devices laying around, right? You can use this grouping of devices and really move those carts from facility to facility and keep their testing dates. So that's why we're bringing this to you today.
And this is the first year this is happening? But like the online?
Yeah, we piloted it last year, I think, at Eastern.
Can you help me visualize this? Because I haven't been in a building and seen one of these. Is the purpose of the cart to like be able to move them from building to building, like it's a protected type thing? Or I'm visioning like a cart and the computer sitting on top of it. That's what it must not be.
Well, it's a cart with all the slots in it.
Yes. Okay, so you can put them all in.
The cart also conditions for charging, so we charge the devices so that somebody doesn't go through the test and the devices.
Exactly, and so you put them in there and they charge, you put them in the van, you can place them.
It's a whole part.
Thank you.
And I'm not sure I mentioned it, but we're using Red Sea contract pricing for this one, so. And the name is the vendor. All right, the next one is a, an interesting one. So back in October, the board approved a vendor for UTEP Television, or SCT as we call them, to install our new public address and clock systems at all the rest of our schools. We installed the Kinhawk system at Orchardview, that's being installed over at Central Middle, and as well as in the administration and transition center building. So we brought forward to you that we would like to continue that with the rest of our schools. That is an item also, I don't have it on here, that is an item that was addressed in our security assessment report by FCC. And we know it, right? We know the system's old, it's starting, you know, parts are getting harder, it's clunky. And so in this day and age, we need something that you can get a message out quicker, right, to staff. So we brought that to you back in October, we recommended SBT, and then once, the way the process works is once the board approves it, then we begin to work with the vendor on the contract. As we were working with the vendor on the contract, they are required to get what's called a performance bond. So if there's anything that goes wrong during it, the district has something to go back to recoup its money. Right, that we have spent, that we've paid the vendor, think of that, something goes haywire, or if they go out of business, that type of thing. They were unable to secure a performance bond. So we've spent quite a bit of time with them and allowing them the opportunity to try to get that performance bond. And so since they aren't able to secure it, we step back and say, well, now we need to come back to the board. And we're recommending Parkway Electric using the same bid that they did. They were the other vendor that bid that Kinhawk system. There were two other vendors that bid a separate different product. And so we want to stick with that Kinhawk so that we have some consistency across it. So we're recommending to you today Parkway Electric for an amount that takes the $3,583,100. It does include some contingency funds in there. And I just listed the two bids down at the bottom for the two that had the care boxes. And I didn't put the other two from October. I wanted to go back and look at the other two, but we didn't like their product and it wasn't.
Can you remind me what it was about Sportsview that we liked more than Parkway? Because Parkway was the technical low bidder by
they had a fraction. They had more of a local presence that is dedicated to these systems. And then they had a better monitoring system than what Parkway has to see if something was not working, then they would be able to do that. And so that is the reason why we have recommended them. So a little disappointed that they weren't able to secure that.
But Parkway's done a good job for us so far.
They have. It wasn't anything that they did that said, oh, we don't want to use them because we have a bad experience with them. That wasn't the case. You know, it's been fine as we've worked through at Central Middle with them. We haven't had any issues. It was kind of those two bonuses that SBT had, which is fine.
What precludes one from securing a performance bond?
You know, my guess is it's the duration, because this wasn't all done in this sort of time. It wasn't in the next year, that type of thing. It's a multi-year project, and a large dollar amount sometimes.
So, just curious, obviously this is unavoidable on our end. Did we spend money with SBT in any way to date on this early going? We didn't do anything already, obviously, right? And I can look back to, do you remember what our all-in with contingency was for them?
It was actually a little bit more than this. I mean, that's the biggest thing for us. We're really anxious to get this one built.
obviously their original bid still stands, and we talked with them, and all that stuff is all still the same. Awesome.
All right, the next agenda item is request, so this is one of those annual things that you should be on from your LLC. So our local taxing authorities, so we have Cascade Charter Townships, City of Grand Rapids, Kentwood, City of Kentwood, and Grand Rapids Charter Township. We receive information from them to request to strike delinquent personal property tax control, so think of the equipment that's inside the facility. So taxes that are uncollected after 5 years, they have the ability to request that they're serving for the rolls. They don't have to continue to try and capture that. So they do that every year. We get some. Sometimes we don't have anything. So if you look at Ada Township in the chart, for example, they haven't had anything for the last couple of years. And I think they're zero right here, so I'm not sure. I don't think we've heard from them yet. So they may come back with something. Over and do what they do, but otherwise, right now it's just Cascade, City of Grand Rapids, Kentwood, and Grand Rapids Charter Township. You can see the different amounts that they're requesting. So some of them go back just the 5 years, a couple of them go back a little bit further. They don't have to request all of those. Some of them, I think, they're actively trying to still collect those, but then when they kind of just say, uncle, and we give, then that's when they ask the board. And this is just a part of the process that they have to follow. They have to get permission from the local school districts to have those certificates. So that is what we do today.
And does this physically translate into dollars that we have already received in tax revenue that we then pay back to these municipalities who are not? No.
No.
Correct. This is just dollars that they physically
have
never been able to collect. We've never received any part of these dollars from there. They just need our approval.
And then another same terms, refunded property taxes. We have a request from the county to reimburse $11,220. All right, those are action items. I'm not super excited to get them up. Under administrative update, Christine, it's also that time of year for schools of choice. And the district is starting to look at that. And so Christine is going to take a few minutes here and walk you through schools of choice.
So our policy on schools of choice, which is really just the first slide that I could talk to Ms. Julie's point about, really just indicates that that I determine the number of openings and then complete the process. Most of that goes through Tommy in my office, the actual paperwork. Typically what we'll do is sit down and have it and determine how many spots we have available. Once we decide that it's posted at the ISD, we don't post, some districts post by grade level, we do not do that. We just post a total number of openings because we believe it gives us the most flexibility in placing it. Because that timeline is in the spring. So some of the time when we're placing kids, we are making a guess at how many students might be, or how many slots might be available, I should say, next fall. So what we do is when we accept a student, we will say that their assignment in the building is tentative, because that gives us the flexibility to look at the numbers in the fall and say, ooh, we really need more students at this building or that building, and we can kind of move people around. We always take their school of preference and take that information, and if it works out beautifully, like it did this last year, we were actually able to move people into buildings that they preferred, and it worked out really well. Sometimes it's not quite that clean, and they can be a little upset when their placement changes, but we do everything that we can to ensure the students that we've selected don't put us into a position where we have to add a section or do what we've put an overload in place. So we also just, and I think you guys know this, but once we accept a student through school of choice or offer them a position, we can renege on that offer if they have had suspensions or an expulsion in the previous 2 years. After that, that once they're accepted, they are a Forestville student. Sometimes the question comes up, you know, if there are behavior issues or discipline issues, can't you just make them go back to their resident district? We can't at that point. We would treat them exactly like any other student in our district. So, there we go. Okay. This shows 10 years of data of the openings that we've posted and then the number of students that we've been able to place. Ranges anywhere between 115 and 150 openings have been posted. You can see there were a couple years, which is interesting, right around COVID, where we actually were able to place students in all of the openings. What happens in the years where it doesn't match, because if we post, let's say, 150 openings, we're obligated to place 150 students in that initial placement in April. But sometimes they actually have until the first day of school to show up or withdraw. So sometimes the first day of school rolls around, they have made another decision. What happens is we then go to our wait list, but some of those people on the wait list have already gone to a school of their second choice or their third choice, and they no longer want to uproot and come to Forestville. So we aren't always able to fill all of our spots, and that's what happens. The last 2 years, we've posted 120 openings, I believe, and we've filled only 100. This shows we really make an effort to try to place students at the earlier levels. The feeling is that they're more successful if we can bring them into Forest Hills sooner. They get acclimated to our academic programming, our PBIS programming, whatever that is, and they're more successful. So you can see, the number's not on there, but between kindergarten and fourth grade is really about two-thirds of the students that we place year to year to year, and I can show you another couple years. But and then we place about, this last year it was, let's say, 12% at the fifth and sixth grade level, anywhere between 7 and 14% at 7th and 8th. And then at 9th and 10th, we don't accept 11th or 12th grade students. So at 9th and 10th, it ranges about the same, anywhere around 10%. What we try to do is accommodate students, and I'll tell you a little bit more about the process, but we try to accommodate students who've been in Forest Hills and may have moved out. So most of those students that are accepted at 9th and 10th grade, and even 7th and 8th grade often, are kids who've been here, but they moved out and they want to remain in Forest Hills. So if we see those names as we're kind of running through the process, we'll do our best to accommodate people. So we do a random draw. It has to be by law random. You put the names in a hat, you pull the names out, and then we literally go from the first student selected is a kindergarten student. Great, we'll place a kindergarten student. The second student selected is fifth grade, and we place that way. Once you get toward the bottom of the list, we may find that we don't have any more, let's say, high school slots. And so we can skip a grade and then go to more kindergarten students. That's how we focus on the younger students. Otherwise, you could expect that if it's a random draw, there'd be an even number of people in every grade.
You said, is it just a fact that most of the kids that are interested in 9th and 10th grade are moved out?
No.
That's what I'm, if you have 20 of them and they're 20th on the list, they're never going to come back. It could still be a kid's
right.
Okay.
Because we can't.
Right? I know. Just when you said that, I was going to say we can't do that.
No.
Presumably, most of them that apply is because that's their situation.
Most of them.
Yeah, okay.
And so the skewing towards younger just have to have a backing. It's not initial criteria.
Right.
It's just that we only have so many 9th grade slots available, they fill up, and then by default, younger kids end up filling the rest of the.
Yep. It's not that there are more necessarily kindergarten. There are probably more kindergarten applications because there are people, you know, who want to bring their kids in from the very beginning of their school experience. But once you get to the other grades, it's not that there are fewer all of a sudden first grade applications. It's that we try to take more of those students. We have more openings at that level. So this just shows, again, it's two other years, but it'll show you pretty much the same progression. We take as many kindergarten students as we can. And this slide just shows by building the number of employees students. So we also, in fact, we just sent out a letter to employees. Under the school code, we can, don't have to, but can accept employees' children in the school district regardless of where they reside. And again, we try to accommodate those requests to the information first right now, so that when we do the school of choice placement, we already know how many slots are gonna be taken up by employees' children.
So we just take those out of circulation in terms of the available spots, we're allowed to just put those people in slots.
They're different buckets.
Yeah, okay.
So we still, after we place employees' children, we still have whatever number of spots we post, so let's say 120 school of choice slots that we can fill.
Okay.
So you really add the two to get the total. Every once in a while, there's a non-resident, which you see the tiny blue line. That might be a student who moved out second semester or moved out in November, and we give them the ability to complete the year here, but then they need to either come through school of choice or they can't return to Forest Hills. ADA is running at a 9% school of choice. Ada Vista's got a tiny bit, and again, that is students. Students aren't eligible to go to Ada Vista as kindergarten students because they would have missed the lottery, essentially. But if they move out after and they come back through school of choice, often we'll let them stay in the Spanish immersion program because we have the slots available. So we try to do that. Commons is at 12%, Nat Forest is 6%, Meadow Brook 13%, Orchard View 14%, Pine Ridge is only 4%, and Thornapple is about 6%. It shifts year to year, but historically, if you think about Meadow Brook, Orchard View, Collins, those have been schools where attendance has been kind of dropping off. Ada has been dropping off quite a bit also. Central Woodlands and Northern Trails, because you're doing the accumulation, are both interesting, like right at 9%. So 9% of the students who attend Central Woodlands and Northern Trails are school of choice students. Central Middle is lower, which is interesting. I don't know if it will be over time, but Central Middle is 5%, Eastern Middle is 10%, and Northern Hills Middle is 12%. That starts going up a bit just because, you know, the numbers compound over time. So you can see how the numbers of students obviously increase because they've been in the system for a longer period of time. Central High, Eastern, Central High is only 6%. Eastern and Northern are at 12% and 11%, respectively. There are transition students, two students, but because there are only 19 students in that program, it's a, you know, it's a decent percentage, it's about 11%. Again, those are students who, once they come here under school of choice, they can complete our entire programming while they're here. We have over the past couple years, accepted students in the Chinese immersion program through choice, simply because we haven't had enough local interest to fill those spots. That's a decision that we're going to have to look at moving forward. And whether we just need to look at somehow changing the programming a little bit, because it doesn't necessarily on the surface make sense to have to be trying to fill your numbers in a program with non-resident children. So we're looking at that one pretty carefully. We've accepted as many children as applied into that program, and we still aren't running sections of 25. So that's a challenging one. So it's at that time again where we post the number of slots. Given the fact that we haven't even really been able to fill 120, I'm not sure it makes sense to post any more than that.
But you said if it's 120, it might be 100 because kids make other choices. If we did 150, then we might get 120.
If you, yes, if you
right.
Want to 100, yes.
You know what I mean? Because you try to figure out that. So that's my big question. How do you determine who remains?
It's a challenge. And you also have to be careful. So a great example is
Right,
and that was pretty traumatic for a lot of people.
Yes.
That we had to cut a section. The question was posed at the time, correctly, and I always posed in principles, because when we get close like this, we will say, do you want to take 10 more school of choice children to save a section or not? And typically the answer will be no. In the past, even before my time, I think there was a maybe not a formal, but maybe an informal level where we said we only want about 10% school of choice children in all of our buildings. Well, there are buildings that are over that now.
Right.
There are buildings that are under. When posed to ADA again, do we want to take 20 school of choice students at ADA to fill another section? The answer was no.
Do you ask why?
much at the early level. But at the upper levels, it's you're not typically going to move at an upper grade level unless you're dissatisfied with where you are. So why are you dissatisfied with where you are? And so that might mean that their child's not having a successful experience.
Right, but K-4, you would assume that's the case.
Well, yeah, maybe K, or right. I mean, even then, still, mm-hmm. perhaps, probably, you know, or whatever. Mm-hmm. But we can control that, right? I mean, or because we can, first, if we wanted to increase the number, we could increase them all and make it a better level. If we wanted to and say, we will only we'll take 20% spots just entering school.
We could say that we're only posting, only accepting applications for kindergarten students.
Right.
And we're going to accept 150 kindergarten students.
Or, but even to our general number, we could just say we're going to go from 120 to 150, and all 30 of those are going to be kindergartners, those additional 30 slots, whatever.
You can't do that exactly. If we post 150, I have to take 150. There may not be.
Oh, that's right. But
that would
still be
up.
Right.
But like, yeah. Right. But like you said, yeah, once they're full, they're full. So,
right. Kindergarten's full, but then
yes.
I have to go to another level.
Yes.
But
so
kindergarten
I have
is 30
to...
more. If
yes.
we said we don't have 100 kindergarten spots, we have 130.
As long as we have 30 additional
right.
kindergarten applicants.
If the openings,
as long as you had more applicants.
Right, of course.
We don't, so we don't, we typically try to take as many kindergarten students as possible.
Right,
right.
There aren't many who are left in the lottery.
Okay.
So where in the balance, both of you, for the whole thing, you know, becomes the our diminishing kindergarten class every year, and our right, financial stability and all that, using school choice as what it is, a way to be, you know, to have a budget that stays more consistent year to year. I mean, and is that?
You know, there have been districts in our county that have used school choice to make this budget. The challenge with that can be. They don't live in the community, so at any point in time, and that can happen with people who live in our community, you can up and move, but there's that. You know, we have challenges with transportation, because we don't provide transportation for students of choice, right? Once you sign up, you know that you're transferring your students. You know, we have that brings a whole other set of challenges for the building, right? And families who drop their kids off early, and, you know, and then we've got a supervision issue, because they're dropping them off early because they need to go somewhere else, right?
It's underway.
Further away, you know, that type of thing. So it brings some challenges when it comes to that. I've just never been a fan of balancing the budget.
And of course, you can't look at it just in isolation, because obviously, right, there's money and more things that maybe make it harder when you do that. Okay.
Mary might have more history than I do, because I think it was before my time.
It was.
Where there was kind of that movement to balance the budget on school choice. And we had a lot of school choice kids enter. And
we didn't manage it well. We just ended up with 40% in the freshman class in Northern High School. So that was just our aha moment,
right,
that we have to do this. You know, oh good, we need 100 kids, let's take them all. Oopsie, 80 of them are right. So that was just bad oversight. I don't remember being a budget balancing thing. I think it was just we didn't realize we had to oversee that program a little more diligently. Do you know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
And needless to say, grade, totally wrong, did not have the resources, did not have kids prepared or accustomed to our traditions. Do you know what I mean? So just when we're looking at these huge budget cuts, is it time to sit down and have some discussions and some PD, and what resources do we need? And you guys know way better than us, but you know what I mean? It just makes me sad that the teachers would rather see their staff, their coworkers, have to not continue in their profession than take 10 new kids and see if they can help them out their life.
I don't think it's that serious. It's
okay.
Not that they're not continuing. They're just moving to a different building.
Yeah.
So in this
so
case,
far.
Well, we have
cut down
1,000
kids.
Oh,
overall,
long term.
Right.
I
guess maybe,
should
I say PD, do we start those discussions? Because this isn't going to change, you know?
We have fewer young kids in our district.
Right.
You know,
districts, and I don't know the numbers anymore, you might know more. Northview is over, I believe, 40%
yes,
school choice students.
Yeah,
I'm sure.
And I think it's a balancing act.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
I think as you get another reason to take students at an earlier age is they are perceived as Forest Hills students.
Right.
What I've seen in other districts, not Forest Hills, but when you start having older students come, it becomes that an argument then of, wait a second, my child was the lead in the play, and now some kid moving in is the lead in the play,
sure, yeah,
or the star basketball player, or the star football player, you know, whatever it is, and they don't even live in our district. So it's a really fine line between balancing what, I'll say, taxpayers
yep.
believe that they're paying for,
mm-hmm.
whether they perceive that opportunities are being taken away from taxpayers because of other students. Not understanding that maybe those opportunities wouldn't be there if we didn't have the money to support the program.
Yeah.
So I trust me, I understand both sides, but it gets really, it can be very complex.
For sure.
Yes.
Yeah, I can believe that.
The whole situation is complex, and again, we gear towards lower kids. We don't do the professional sophomores because then you are taking the football quarterback position, all that. I get that. But we have always kind of leaned towards the younger kids and hope they can acclimate and be exposed to our stuff. Just might be time to broaden the discussion, especially with the A to 10, you know, going down to two sections that.
Well, that was one of my questions, is that you didn't have a rough idea of kindergarten sections across all the buildings this year versus 5 years ago or 6 years ago or something, and we lost.
Well, we don't have any students be lost.
I'm right, we know the number of kids. So
the principals do what we used to call Roundup. I think they have a better name for it now, but they do kindergarten Roundup in March, April. That gives us a little better sense. What we've noticed over the past few years, and I'm not sure if it's a trend or hopefully a one-off, but parents aren't enrolling their kids right away. So even when you do the Roundup, we're not getting very good numbers. I know the principals have really kind of, they'll try to go through the PTO, go through neighborhoods, right? Remember to tell your neighbors if you, they'll put things in the newsletter. If you know that your neighbor's planning on sending their kindergarten child, make sure they come in and sign up. But it's really difficult to tell, I'll be honest.
And the only other thing, comment by people who, you know, used to run in the profession, is that we can't afford to buy houses in Forest Hills now as young families. So it's not uncommon that people are moving just to the outskirts, and those are the people that we might tap into if we said, yes, we're paying 20 extra kindergarten sections. You know, somebody that would have lived in Forest Hills, who would have had $500,000 to buy a home.
You want to be like first, move into the district later on if they can.
Right, so the whole dynamic is changing. Just so I hope we don't say it's bad, it doesn't work, we have problems, but we also need money and we have to find your moment. So it might be time to say it's going to be a little more challenging, but how can we get ahead of it and, you know, do what's best for our kids, right? Just start the discussion, maybe, right?
So the challenge with starting the discussion is we have less than a month at this point to tell the numbers.
5 years. This is a month. Over time, you know, everybody look back at Ava. Is this really what we want to do in Forest Hills? Or do we sit down and actually have discussions? We have these perceptions that maybe could be addressed or maybe aren't even accurate. You know, what are truly the issues that make us nervous and what do we need to do to address those? Or are we fine just knowing that we're going to stick with our 10 to 15% and we might
continue
just,
to adopt sections.
We might have two sections in about
every
10 years. So no, I'm not saying this year, over time, could we, you know, right? Task force, focus group, you know what I'm saying? Impact, teacher, you know what I'm saying? It's lovely, you know, you have teachers saying, I'm so scared I'm not going to have a job in 2 years, but I'm also not willing to take extra kids. Well, life is about choices. You know, how do we make this work so everybody feels that we have options that can satisfy everybody? Is that making sense, or is that I'm sorry?
That makes sense.
Okay,
yeah,
good.
For sure.
Thank you.
For sure.
Not this year.
So, yeah, I think our thinking had been to keep the number about the same this year. We could ratchet it up to 130 instead of 120 and see what happens. But
if your school's
ready
for it,
spots.
I'd love that you've asked them. If they're saying no, well, there's consequences to that, then guess what? There might be two sections. So you asked the great questions. That's wonderful.
Yeah.
People are being given that chance to give their input, and this is what happens, and that's okay.
I think what they like is a nice balance. I think that 10%, 15% to 5% to 10%, you know, I think that is what principals believe is a really nice mix, and it can be managed well, and students acclimate, and it works out really
well. Is that the same perception in at the kindergarten level where everyone is new, where everyone is entering the building for the first time, the difference between 10% and 20% would make a difference.
Those have
been
my conversations with principals when they have these, yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
Also, perception of time, we're not looking at cutting $2 million and potentially affecting people's livelihoods. I mean, you know, again, we have pie in the sky, but no more in a totally different playing field now.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so it's sometimes we don't see that the situation has changed. So yeah, that's ideal.
Right.
However, you know,
and we've gone, I don't know how many years. I think I do know how many years. We've gone about 13 years since we've even talked about a staff layoff, a teacher layoff.
Right.
And those teachers at that moment who were laid off were all recalled. Because that was the summer I came on board. The teachers had been laid off and we ended up recalling every one of them. When you don't have that experience, so think about it, you're almost 15 years in, give or take half our staff, if you want to assume that people go 30 years, who don't understand the ramification necessarily,
right?
They've never felt it. we have been able to make adjustments through attrition. We might be reducing sections, we might not be replacing people who leave, but nobody's lost their job. They might be reassigned, but I surely don't like that. So where in Forest Hills, a reassignment, and I'm not trying to minimize, I'm being honest here, a reassignment is just as traumatic as somebody in another district who might be laid off and losing their job. Because by and large, we've been able to accommodate everything a teacher wants, and they stay in the same buildings and they develop the family. In other districts that deal with more of these issues, you have a job. You might be in Collins this year, but it might be in Meadowbrook next year. That's great, because you've got a job. That's just not our culture. So I think you're right, Mary. In part, the option isn't real. I've never felt that. I've never known anybody that happened.
So when you talk about 13 years ago, is that when we made that $400 mid-year dollar adjustment in our foundation allowance? That was your thought.
I know the district, when I came aboard, the district was going through cuts. We had cut quite a few support staff.
I'm just trying to remember which year that was. Okay.
That was literally my first job when I came in, was to review who had been laid off and see if those were the right people who had been laid off. I don't really know, to be honest, what came before. I just remember trying to pick up the pieces of that situation.
Right.
It
just, life is different. So I know we say this is perfect, but we're not in the same place we were before. So at least, to continue that talk.
Yeah.
Right.
It's like everything else, it's just complex. Right? Yes. There's just a lot of factors that need to be considered.
Yes.
I also wanted to just bring you up to speed very briefly. I think you're aware Sue Gutierrez has announced her retirement. So last week, we started that hiring process. The position was posted. Last week I went over and met with the staff, and we always do a kind of a process where we talk about what are the qualities of the principal that you would like us to hire to take this building to the next level. Always a really interesting discussion. They were great. It was a voluntary meeting, and I don't think there were many people missing. Almost everybody was there.
It's cool.
That building is very, they've only had two principals apparently. I didn't even know this since the building opened.
Yeah.
So a lot of consistency, a lot of tradition. We had that conversation. They gave me some qualities. And then I always follow up by saying, basically, the success or failure of that next principal is up to the staff in this room. Because somebody is going to come in and not know that hidden culture, if you will. They are going to step in something. They're going to do something that doesn't satisfy you. Give them some grace. Talk to them about it.
They talk about
because
it, right.
Before you get mad and just assume they're changing everything, they probably just don't even know. So we had that conversation about that the staff needs to help the next principal be successful. It's been a long time. Position is posted. The posting is up on the 19th of February. And then we'll be doing initial interviews. We'll do all of the screening. Sometimes we send out another request. If there are a lot of candidates and we really are having a hard time narrowing down on paper, we will sometimes send out a request for a video response or a written response. And we try to get it down to around 10 candidates that go through an initial interview. That should be happening about the second week of March. And then, Mary, you participated before in the building level interview. So then we have a building level interview normally with three or four candidates, and they will do a series of different kind of events while they're there. They'll have an interview. Everybody's favorite part is the student-led tour, where students will take a candidate around the building and tour them. So we collect feedback from all of those people and then determine who the superintendent will be.
We also do a staff meeting, and I can't remember what the fourth thing is, but you make sure that those candidates interact with every one of the constituencies, which is really cool.
We've had
an amazing process.
Well over 100 staff, parents, students participate in some of the hires. Sometimes it's, for whatever reason, less popular, and we have fewer people. But yeah, it can be it's an interesting process.
Yes.
And anybody who wants to participate can participate in one way or another. So we hope to have that done before spring break. Should we go?
Hired
before spring break.
Good.
Yep.
Yeah. A little transition time.
I'm sorry?
A little transition time.
Yes.
That would be lovely.
Yeah, well, to be, the candidate pool is dropping for teachers, for administrators, for everyone. The sooner we can know, the sooner another district can move on and post a position. So I think, you know, as best we can, do something for clients.
No, I'm just thinking, Mary's comment, the transition, the person might not start.
But they might show up once in a while.
Give them a day, or half a day, or something.
And avoid some of those hoops I stepped in it because, ooh, I didn't know people did that.
Right, just saying, four times.
You know, maybe, so that's lovely that you're planning that way.
Typically invite them to the year-end administrative body.
Right.
Any kind of year-end training that we do or professional learning with our administrators, we're going to have to do some learning around evaluation. I mean, all of those things, we can include the person.
Exactly.
So, yeah, it's super helpful the earlier we do that. So, that'll be coming up, too. If you're interested in participating.
That was all. Yeah, thank you. That was helpful. Anything else?
Yeah.
Okay.
Thanks, everybody.
Thanks.